Thank you so much. Thank you all for being here. And before I forget, a special thank you to Jennifer Burge and her team, because my presentation does not happen without the help of audiovisual equipment. So it's my pleasure to be here with you today. I'm just going to jump right into it, and I'll talk a little bit about my work as we go along. Can I go ahead? I think I can. Okay, there we go. Counterinsurgency. A euphemism for oppression. Now I'm going to talk to you about Iraq because that's the area where I have the most information. It's where I've been, but a lot of the oppression that we see in Iraq today is also seen in Afghanistan. And I'll touch on that briefly, but I think through the day today we'll hear other viewpoints and perspectives on the matter. There's my name. All of that schooling and education means for me today is that I'm in an incredible amount of debt. But I left that all behind for what I think is more important. My website is liberatethis.com, and there's a section on further reading where I have references for this talk and many other topics, and you can also reach me through the website. I take it all, questions, comments, love mail, hate mail, whatever you got. I am going to show graphic photos because I want you to see the truth. Because in my view, if enough people see the truth, then our policies would change. So they are graphic photos. that's just a reminder. I am showing personal family photos as well. I would ask that you don't take any images of those photos. However, as always, I encourage you to take pictures of me. Okay, moving on. So in January 2010, David Petraeus, sometimes Petraeus tries to interrupt my talk, so please put your phones on silent or vibrate. In January 2010, David Petraeus wrote a brief article called Counterinsurgency Concepts, What We Learned in Iraq. And he boiled it down to four major take-home points. Focus on the people, work across boundaries, exercise initiative, and live our values. So I want to lay that down as the foundation, and I'm going to come back to that at the end of my talk. In this, David Petraeus, he stated, "Indeed, we now find ourselves and the Iraqi people in a much better place than 2 years ago, with progress on all fronts, security, economic, and political. The gains achieved in Iraq have been considerable." That's a very happy picture he's writing there in January 2010. But this is a message I got from a friend of mine who lives in Iraq. This is from last week. He's 21 years old. "I live in Iraq. Sorry for saying this, but life in Iraq is like shit. And I really want to get out soon. I was living in Fallujah once from 2000 to 2005, and my mother has cancer, breast cancer. Believe me, I live in hell. There's no hope here, no future. They killed our loving spirit. Just left the hating. They made us hate Iraq. I hope someone shows me the light in the end of this dark tunnel." So obviously, there are different perspectives going on, and David Petraeus cannot speak for the Iraqi people. But I'm going to show you why he feels like this and why many Iraqis are suffering today. So I'm going to run through a brief introduction, then I want to look at some definitions. I'll talk very superficially about counterinsurgency in our recent history in Vietnam, in El Salvador, and in Iraq. But I want to put Iraq in context of our policy in that country in the last 30 years. And then we'll bring it all home with a conclusion. So let's do it. This is a picture of my father, born and raised in Iraq. I found this picture at my uncle's house during my last trip in 2006, and I brought it home. And I was like, "Dad, look what I found." And he said, "Yes, look at this. I am very handsome." And I said, "Yes, and you're very humble too." This is 1961. He's a graduate of Baghdad University. And he did well enough in school to earn a government scholarship to do his graduate studies overseas. So in 1963, he came to the United States, went to Georgetown University. He's living in DC, where he met another graduate student, a nice Jewish girl from New York. Now, don't worry, I'm in therapy and will be for some time. But I will now shamelessly plug that I'm working on a book that will talk about these different perspectives, so I'll leave you in suspense. My parents got married in 1968, had my sister in 1969, and then their lives dramatically improved in 1971 when I came along. Now, this is me at 6 months old. And I'm showing you this picture because this is in our backyard in Basra in Iraq. After my dad finished his graduate education, his obligation through the scholarship was to go back to Iraq and teach for the same number of years that he was here studying in the US. So he got his PhD in 1971, I was born that year too, and so the first 5 years of my life were spent going back and forth between Iraq and the US. When you're a kid, you think everybody does that, apparently that's not the case. But anyway, this is me at 6 months old in June 1972 in Iraq. Now for any of us, the memories we have of our childhood from before our brains could make memories are from the pictures. So you talk to me about Iraq, and I think of this. Unfortunately, we are still well-trained in this society. You talk about Iraq and you think of this. And herein lies the problem. There were 27 million other people living in Iraq besides Saddam Hussein. And you take any country, any population that's ruled by a government. Those people living under that government will either reap the benefits or pay the price of what their government does. And to this day, the Iraqi people are paying the highest price. Now this is an Iraqi family. There's my dad, my sister, and me. And this is an American family. There's my dad, my sister, and me. I was born here. I was born in New York in 1971. My sister was born in DC, and my father became a citizen in the 1980s. So it's blurred, and we all look alike. But to me, because I have family in both places, the shock and awe of Iraq might as well have been the shock and awe of Yonkers, New York. It's the same thing to me. These were my mom's parents, Ashkenazi Jews who fled their homeland of Austria. They became refugees to escape the oppression of the Nazis. They made it to New York to start a new life. So now, unfortunately, I have a history of occupation on both sides of my family, but it's for both sides that I do what I do today. So let's look at some definitions. Insurgency, this is the Department of Defense, has its own dictionary. Published in 2005, Dictionary of Military and Associated Terms. And insurgency is defined as an organized movement aimed at the overthrow of a constituted government through use of subversion and armed conflict. Now, insurgent tends to be a dehumanizing term, and it's usually used to confer a negative connotation. Take, for example, now, Libya. We don't call those people rising up against the government insurgents. We call them rebels. So, but we use the term insurgent, which tends to take away the humanity of that enemy. Now, it would be a lot easier for the Pentagon if this is what an insurgent looked like. But let's look at some examples of insurgency through the years. Now, in my opinion, this is a far better looking insurgent. And this is, of course, from the movie Braveheart, William Wallace, who led the Scottish uprising against the British Empire. And as the movie closes, in the year of our Lord, 1314, patriots of Scotland, not insurgents, patriots of Scotland, starving and outnumbered, charged the fields of Bannockburn. They fought like warrior poets, they fought like Scotsmen, and won their freedom. Now let's look at another set of insurgents against the British Empire. Oh, this would be the founding of our nation. This is a very famous painting of George Washington crossing the Delaware. The story behind this is that on December 25th, Christmas, 1776, the American forces, I'll call them American forces, had retreated from battling the British forces in New Jersey. They went back across the Delaware River to Pennsylvania. And the British were like, okay, great, like it's winter now, we defeated them, we're done until the spring. They entered their winter quarters assuming victory. But very cleverly, in a surprise attack in the middle of the night, George Washington and his troops came back across the Delaware River and ambushed the British forces. Now, we remember that as a very clever strategy, very efficient, and this is how America got its freedom. But I guarantee you that's not how the British looked at what happened. They certainly would call us insurgents, bloody insurgents, if you will. But the founding fathers legitimately drove the British Empire out of North America. So again, the term insurgent is dehumanizing. We hear insurgent, we hear militant, we hear enemy combatant, but we don't hear that these are families. These are human beings, the same way as it's families here in this country. We are now trained that when we see something like this, we think insurgent, or someone who wants to harm Americans. But the reality is that this actually, in this photo, is a college graduate, newly married, who wants to live his life and have a family the same as the rest of us do. But what he was doing in February of 2006 was going out to get bread from the bakery for the family, and they used the scarf to protect their face from the elements. It does get cold in Iraq. So, and I asked him to give me the V-sign so I could take the picture. But that's my cousin. But this is the dehumanization. The term military-aged male is a person of suspicion, and that term military-aged male was used in Vietnam, and it's used in Iraq and Afghanistan today. And this is the other element that's missing. That's me with two of my cousins. This is from 2006, so they don't look like that anymore. But this is the other thing that's missing. If you take a country, a population, if you do the math with me, about half male, half female, add up the women, the girls, and the boys. The majority of any country are women and children. But we only see, typically for this part of the world, we see young men who are very angry. They're often dressed in black, their faces are covered, they're chanting in a language we don't understand, and sometimes they're armed. What we don't see is what our policies are doing that are making them so angry. And we don't see the women and children who are living in the countries that we are occupying. So I defined insurgency, counterinsurgency from the same manual is defined as those military, paramilitary, political, economic, psychological, and civic actions taken by a government to defeat insurgency. In a RAND study on insurgency and counterinsurgency in Iraq in 2004, it was actually noted that counterinsurgency evolved out of imperial policing against an empire's colonies. And from this article, counterinsurgency tactics, born imperial policing tactics, developed to suppress earlier colonial insurrections throughout the 18th, 19th, and early 20th centuries, were often readily adaptable to subsequent mid-20th century campaigns. The RAND study goes on to note that the same tactics of imperial policing used by Great Britain in the 1950s were being used by the United States in Iraq in the first part of the occupation. Now, since 2007, with the COIN manual, perhaps tactics have changed mildly. The outcome is the same. But the battle for hearts and minds was over before it started, and I will come back to that. So let's look at some examples of counterinsurgency. Under the British Empire, as I mentioned, Scotland rising up against the British Empire, and the British attempt to crush it was counterinsurgency. And the British attempt to crush revolution in the American colonies was also counterinsurgency. Now let's look at American Empire. We use counterinsurgency in Vietnam to crush resistance there, counterinsurgency in El Salvador, and we use counterinsurgency operations in Iraq and Afghanistan today. What's important to note, again, from this RAND study, is that Vietnam and Iraq thus form two legs of a historically fraught triangle. Historically fraught because, as the RAND study describes, there were disappointing results. With America's experiences in El Salvador in the 1980s providing the connecting leg. So what I want to do is look at counterinsurgency, again, just skimming the surface, in Vietnam, El Salvador, and Iraq. So let me start with Vietnam. In Vietnam, the Pentagon developed the CORDS program, CORDS standing for Civil Operations and Revolutionary Development Support. And the purpose of this program was to coordinate U.S. civil and military pacification programs in Vietnam. Now, they were using anthropologists at this time, and they used the data collected by those anthropologists to map the human terrain to find Viet Cong sympathizers and kill them. Now, just 11 days ago, this city, this state, and this nation commemorated what happened 10 years ago when foreigners came to this country and killed Americans, if we believe the government's story. Why is it any different when Americans go to foreign countries and kill their people? It's not. Two anthropologists, Roberto Gonzalez and David Price, in an article called When Anthropologists Become Counterinsurgents, During World War II and the Cold War, the U.S. military and intelligence agencies tended to use anthropologists' work to help accomplish immediate goals and discarded all other information that was counter to their beliefs or institutional models. So I have no doubt that anthropologists and other social scientists have very good intentions when they involve themselves with counterinsurgency, but you have to consider the ethical issues of what you're doing to the populations that you're studying. And this is comparable to the American Psychological Association raising ethical issues of psychologists being involved in drawing the parameters for our torture techniques. The famous aspect of the Quartz program, or one of the most prominent, was called Operation Phoenix. And this was, again, finding Viet Cong sympathizers, or suspected sympathizers, and killing them. These were death squads, trained, armed, funded, directed by the American CIA. Between the years of 1968 and 1972, an estimated 26,000 Vietnamese were murdered through Operation Phoenix. But overall, through this campaign to eliminate supporters of the Viet Cong, up to 50,000 people may have been murdered. So that was one aspect of counterinsurgency in Vietnam. Let's look at El Salvador. It's quite similar. This was what we, our policymakers did, was to start a U.S. military assistance program to the Salvadoran government. This was started under President Jimmy Carter in the 1970s, and then really ramped up in the 80s under President Ronald Reagan. A total of $4.5 billion was poured into this assistance program in El Salvador during the decade of the 1980s. Again, counterinsurgency. $1.3 billion of that was in direct military assistance, another over $850 million in unsubsidized credits, and then possibly, in addition, another more than $500 million of CIA investment. $4.5 billion that could certainly have been used here at home. But you see, there's a whole lot of money missing out of that $4.5 billion. And a lot of that money went to the funding and training of so-called nationalist paramilitary forces. This is where the School of the Americas became involved. The School of the Americas was founded in the 1960s, but it became very prominent during the 1980s with basically Central American military personnel, military officers coming to be trained in the United States in tactics of extortion, execution, and torture. Now, the School of the Americas got a bad reputation because the SOA, as it's called, SOA Watch, has drawn a lot of attention to what the hell is going on there. So they changed their name to Western Hemisphere Institute for Security Cooperation. But just as counterinsurgency is a euphemism for oppression, so is this new name a euphemism for the torture training camp of the School of the Americas. Now, I know on the mainstream media, they would like to show images of alleged terrorist training camps in Afghanistan. Here we have a terrorist training camp in Fort Benning, Georgia. Our funding in El Salvador led to a five-fold expansion of Salvadoran armed forces during the 1980s. And again, this is just as in Operation Phoenix, these are death squads. They targeted the rebel leaders and their supporters. And if you are familiar at all with what happened in Latin America at that time, society was characterized by tens of thousands of innocent civilians being killed and disappeared, including members of the Catholic Church, including Archbishop Oscar Romero, and including four American nuns who were kidnapped and brutally raped, beaten, and murdered. In total, an estimated 75,000 Salvadorans were killed. This is up from the 50,000 in Vietnam. But overall, in our operations in El Salvador, in Guatemala, in Honduras, in Nicaragua, an estimated more than 300,000 people died with our policy in the 1980s. And so let's look at this again. The RAND study mentioned that Vietnam and Iraq thus formed two legs of a historically fraught counterinsurgency triangle, with America's experiences in El Salvador in the 1980s providing the connecting leg. We had death squads in Vietnam, we had death squads in El Salvador, and I'm probably, for most of you, introducing to you that we have death squads in Iraq. But first, let's look at a little bit of background of what we've done to Iraq in the last 30 years. In the 1980s, the Iran-Iraq War. With our tacit support, Saddam Hussein attacked Iran. And then for the next 8 years, we armed and funded and provided satellite intelligence to Saddam Hussein and the Iraqi army. Oh, look at this happy photo here. December 20th, 1983. On your left, Donald Rumsfeld. At that time, private citizen, special envoy to President Reagan, reaffirming our close ties in the region with our ally in Iraq. That's Saddam Hussein on your right. The Iran-Iraq war is well underway. We are, as I said, providing conventional, chemical, biological weapons to Iraq. Now, the crimes for which Saddam Hussein was executed in 2006 happened in 1982. This is December 20th, 1983, and Donald Rumsfeld looks pretty happy. It doesn't seem to be bothering him too much. Now, a lot happened between 1988 and 1990. It'll all be in the book. I don't have time to go into it now. But the next period was the Gulf War and sanctions. On August 2nd, 1990, Iraq invaded Kuwait. 4 days later, economic sanctions were imposed as punishment for occupying Kuwait and to encourage Iraq to move back out. Over the next 6 months, all negotiation attempts were dismissed by the United States as non-starters. And in January of 1991, the US and UK-led air assault on Iraq began. It lasted for 42 consecutive days. We dropped 88,500 tons of bombs on a country slightly larger than the size of California. And we targeted civilian infrastructure, which was in direct violation of international law, specifically the Geneva Conventions. We destroyed the healthcare system in Iraq, what had been a first-class system that relied on electricity, and we bombed 4 of the 7 electrical grids in Iraq. We used depleted uranium. That's another lecture there. But essentially, when we use uranium in our weapons, on impact, the uranium bursts into flames and aerosolizes. So it becomes a microscopic dust that's radioactive. It is the most likely cause for the increase in cancers in Iraq after the first Gulf War and the sharp increase in Iraq's infant mortality rate. It is also the most likely cause of Gulf War syndrome. The economic sanctions that were imposed against Iraq to encourage them to get out of Kuwait were continued for the next 12 years, despite the fact that Iraq was no longer occupying Kuwait. It's estimated that during this period, because of malnutrition, starvation, and lack of basic medicines, between 1.2 and 1.8 million dead in Iraq. 500,000 of those dead were children. Now, what would we do if another country's policy killed 500,000 American children? We'd be upset. This is the result. This is the malnutrition we brought to Iraq. These images, however, were not being shown. Again, we saw Saddam Hussein, not the 27 million people living in Iraq. And many of these children ended up here. This is a cemetery specifically for children, and you see how cramped the headstones are. And I just want to point out that this is February 2003. And now here we come to Shock and Awe. So let's move on. Shock and Awe was not just a catchy name. It was actually a position paper called Shock and Awe, Achieving Rapid Dominance, written by Harlan Ullman and James Wade at the National Defense University. And so basically, from the title, this is how to control a population, the method to control a population. And actually, when I visited my family in Iraq, my cousins translated from what they had in Arabic back to English to me, and they called it shock and fear, which is an appropriate description of what our effort was. The authors wrote, "The goal of Shock and Awe Achieving Rapid Dominance will be to destroy or so confound the will to resist that an adversary will have no alternative except to accept our strategic aims and military objectives." Well, let's paraphrase this a little bit. Now, the invasion of Iraq was illegal in violation of several standards of international law, including the UN Charter, and it was massive violence. So this was a calculated use of unlawful violence. So let me just paraphrase that a little bit. And the goal of that calculated use of unlawful violence will be to destroy or so confound the will to resist. That is to coerce or to intimidate an adversary. And in this particular case, the adversary was Iraqis, the Iraqi government, or Iraqi society in general. so that Iraqis will have no alternative except to accept our strategic aims and military objectives. In other words, our political agenda. So what we're left with is the goal of our calculated use of unlawful violence will be to coerce or to intimidate so that Iraqis will have no alternative except to accept our political agenda. If you look at the Department of Defense's dictionary under terrorism, this is what the definition fits. And this is what we did to the Iraqi people. Now, did we terrorize Saddam Hussein? Not so much. He made videos, released clips of speeches, and eventually he was captured and executed. But as I said, there are families. Every country is made up of families. This was the destruction of Baghdad. There are families living there. Now, this is one of my cousins back in 2004. He's a lot older now. But half the population of Iraq is under 18. This is my cousin, and knock on wood, he's doing fine. This is somebody else's cousin. And they're not going to show you these images in the mainstream media, because that's bad public relations for continuing an illegal occupation. And this is the grief that we don't see. These people are human beings, and they love their children just like we do. So when shock and awe was over, here comes occupation. And this is now our effort for counterinsurgency in Iraq, where we have no business being there. Now, the standard from the beginning was the standard tactic of empire, divide and conquer. Just like the British did, we did the same. What was first set up was called the Coalition Provisional Authority, headed by L. Paul Bremer. And what that authority did, all American administrators, was select an initial Iraqi governing council. And we mandated that there would be sectarian divisions at that point. We said there will be a certain number of Shia, certain number of Sunnis, certain number of Kurds, even though Kurds, most Kurds are Sunni, then it gets confusing, certain number of Turkmen, certain number of Assyrian. We established that sectarianism. And some of the members of this Iraqi governing council are familiar to us. One of the 25 members was Ahmed Chalabi, whose group, the Iraqi National Congress, is funded by the State Department. Another member of that council, Iyad Alawi, who for many years was a CIA operative, his group, the Iraqi National Accord, funded by the CIA. So there is no democracy in Iraq. We have, from the beginning, orchestrated what's happening in the Green Zone. Now, other people got jobs after Baghdad fell, and many, many of them did. I'm going to give you my top four. And that would be John Negroponte, former U.S. Army Colonel James Steele, Stephen Castile, and Major General Rashid. I apologize, I don't speak Arabic, and I can't pronounce the last name correctly, so I'm just going to say General Rashid. This investigative work was done by journalist Max Fuller. And if we look at each of these individuals who got jobs when Baghdad fell, we will understand what is happening in Iraq. First, John Negroponte. Whenever you hear John Negroponte's name come up, start running for the hills, because you know the death squads are coming. 1981 to 1985, he served as the U.S. ambassador to Honduras, and during this time, he coordinated U.S. covert aid to the Contras, which were anti-Sandinista militias who targeted civilians in Nicaragua, because we opposed the Sandinista government. He oversaw the U.S. backing of a particularly brutal death squad known as Battalion 316. They were trained and based out of Honduras. And these death squads, like Battalion 316, specialized in torture and assassination. And this is what we saw happening in El Salvador and other Central American countries in the 1980s. Well, guess who got a new job after Baghdad fell? After Paul Bremer left from June 2004 to April 2005, John Negroponte became the U.S. ambassador to Iraq, likely there to oversee the U.S. support to death squads in Iraq. And he came back with the surge, which was another massive amount of violence, with the majority of the victims being the Iraqi people. Moving on, former U.S. Army Colonel James Steele. He started his military career serving in Vietnam. And then from 1984 to 1986, he directed the U.S. Military Advisory Group in El Salvador. What his job was to develop special operating forces at the brigade level during the height of their civil war. It tends to be a pattern that when we get involved in other people's business, the country ends up in civil war. But again, this is all under the umbrella of counterinsurgency operations. Well, Guess who got a new job after Baghdad fell? Jane Steele became counselor to the U.S. ambassador for Iraqi security forces. And that was training special police commando units. This was the new elite Iraqi counterinsurgency unit. And they were operating under Iraq's interior ministry. When Baghdad fell in April, U.S. forces were ordered to secure the Ministry of Oil. We wanted access to those records. Secure the Ministry of the Interior, which was essentially Iraq's CIA. And now we wanted that information protected, and we started operating the Ministry of the Interior. And we secured the oil fields. Everything else was left to be looted. But now, this ex-Army Colonel James Steele, following the invasion, was now operating under Iraq's Interior Ministry. So these are government-sponsored police commando units. Stephen Castile, number three. Stephen Castile was born and raised in Illinois, started his law enforcement career in 1971 as a deputy sheriff, and then became a special agent with the U.S. Department of Justice, with the Bureau of Narcotics and Dangerous Drugs, which was the precursor of the current DEA. In the 1980s and 90s, he continued working with the DIA, which had joint operations with the CIA in Latin America. In 1988, he was involved in Operation Snowcap, which supervised the DEA's jungle suppression activities in Bolivia. Now, jungle suppression activities is coordinating paramilitary death squads, again, under the umbrella of counterinsurgency. And what they experienced at that time, what the population experienced, was rape, torture, and extrajudicial killings. There is a pattern. Now, Stephen Castile continued his career with the DEA in the 80s and 90s, becoming the Assistant Administrator for Intelligence in 1999. And then after Baghdad fell, guess who got a new job? October 2003 to July 2005, he became the Senior Advisor to the Ministry of the Interior, training and creating Iraqi police forces. Now finally, that's the American side of things. They have Iraqis working for them too. Let's look at Major General Rashid and what his CV looks like. He worked for the Ministry of the Interior under Saddam Hussein. We might classify him as an ex-Ba'athist thug. In 1991, when the U.S. administration encouraged the Shia in the southern part of Iraq to rise up against Saddam Hussein responded with a brutal crackdown. Thousands of people were killed. The guy who was in charge of that repression was General Rashid. So he worked for the Ministry of the Interior under Saddam Hussein, and he kept his job after the invasion. We don't really care what people do, as long as they serve the purpose that we have them there for. His role was to develop and train these special police commando units. One particularly feared one, just like Battalion 316, was called the Wolf Brigade. There was another one that had Scorpion in its title, but these are particularly feared groups. Now, this is the Salvador option in Iraq. It's the training by U.S. Special Forces of Iraqi Police Special Commando Units. These are paramilitary death squads. This is what we orchestrated in El Salvador. This is what we orchestrated in Vietnam. Now, there was always suspected that the U.S. was involved in these death squads. Well, the proof came out by WikiLeaks in 2010. This is an article in The Guardian. The U.S. was part of the Wolf Brigade operation against us. And they interview Omar Salem Shahab, who tells of torture at the hands of notorious Iraqi police unit, and says U.S. were involved in his capture. The Americans were there, said Shahab. They weren't just witnesses, they were part of the operation against us. So you remember this happy picture? The more things change, the more they stay the same. There's Donald Rumsfeld and Saddam Hussein in 1983. Fast forward to 2005. There's Donald Rumsfeld, there's General Rashid, and there is Stephen Castile. This is the so-called sectarian strife that has gripped Iraq. Now, 1,400 years ago, there was a battle, there was a dispute over who would lead the Islamic Caliphate, and there was a battle, and that established the sects of Sunni and Shia, 1,400 years ago. Not since then, in Iraq, has there been bloodshed based on Sunni versus Shia. There have been wars of empire. There have been territorial wars. There have been issues of secular government versus religious government. But it hasn't been bloodshed over who's going to lead the caliphate in 1400 years. And if we look at Iraq and if we look at other countries around the world, the bloodshed doesn't start in full force until after U.S. forces arrive. This is the so-called sectarian strife in Iraq. And you might say to me, well, what about all the bombings? What about all the explosions? Sunni blowing up a Shia mosque, Shia blowing up a Sunni mosque. Let's even, like, could they come up with a story that at least makes sense? You want to tell me that people who are so fanatical about their religion will blow up a house of God and incinerate the Quran, which is the writing written down by the Prophet Muhammad. Whether you're Sunni or Shia, Muslims agree that what they believe in is that there is one God, Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet. So it doesn't make sense for Muslims to destroy mosques. But here's what we did find was going on. In September 2005, in Basra, Iraq, in the south, the Iraqi police noticed something odd about two men in a car, two Iraqis in a car. And as they approached the car, the men in the car opened fire. Well, they managed to arrest these Iraqis and detain them. And this is what they found when they brought them back to the police station. These Iraqis were two undercover British special operations. And after they got the crap beat out of them, they were detained. They were going to process them. The British Army came and with a tank knocked out a wall of the police station. Four policemen were killed. About 150 prisoners who were being detained at the prison there were fled. And these two were whisked away before there could be further processing. They were special operations. Now, this is what they had with them. Really ridiculous disguises. Those are their dark hair wigs and the Arabic scarf. And, oh, by the way, this was also in the trunk of their car. Now, I don't carry this around in my trunk, but this is, and I can't identify anything in it, but this is all suspicious for weapons and bomb-making materials. And it makes sense, because fake terrorism is the occupier's best friend. It's divide and conquer. You pit people against each other, and then we run away with the oil. In my own family, my grandmother was Sunni, my grandfather was Shia. They had 10 kids, okay? Something worked out all right between them. The reality in Iraq is that there is all kinds of blending. It's not this purity along religious or ethnic lines. There's a lot of intermarriage along across religious sects, ethnic boundaries, tribal histories. Iraqi society is mixed, and actually even the term mixed didn't emerge until after 2003. But the reality is that we have now in Iraq Sunni-only and Shia-only and Christian-only neighborhoods. This did not exist before we showed up. And the Iraqis don't want it. This is from 2007. The sign says, "With our unity, we destroy all the walls of the occupation." Who put up the walls that divide Baghdad into ghettos, according to religious division? The U.S. Army Corps of Engineers. We set up that division. Now, the good news about that is that we know the quality of the work of the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers from the levees in New Orleans. So it shouldn't take too much to bring these walls down. These are people demonstrating against sectarian division in Iraq. Look again, divide and conquer. The violence we've seen in Iraq in the past several years is comparable during the violence in El Salvador and Nicaragua during CIA-run operations in the 1980s. Donald Rumsfeld and John Negroponte were players in the 80s. Donald Rumsfeld and John Negroponte are players today. We are using terror campaigns to intimidate the population into submission to serve the U.S. agenda. That is what counterinsurgency is all about. So let me wrap it up. Max Fuller, who did the research on everybody who got new jobs in Iraq after the invasion, notes that the pattern is repeated time after time in every imperialist so-called counterinsurgency war. For behind each and every one lurks the reality of exploitation and class war. And as successive imperialist powers have shown, the bottom line in combating the hopes and dreams of ordinary people is to resort to spreading terror through the application of extreme violence. We're in Iraq and we're occupying Afghanistan. It's all about corporate profit. The American people don't want U.S. forces there anymore. Goodness knows U.S. forces don't want to be there anymore. But there's a handful of people making a whole lot of money every day that the occupation continues. The driving force behind the invasion of Iraq, it's sitting on perhaps the largest set of oil reserves in the world. It's been unresearched for the last several decades, but they might even have more oil than Saudi Arabia. And it was also Israelis were involved in the decision to invade Iraq. That was revealed in the Chilcot inquiry in the UK in 2010. In Afghanistan, initially, we wanted to build a pipeline. There's poppy fields there, a whole lot of opium. Now they found all these minerals. Bin Laden is dead. What are we still doing there? As we know, the president's brother, who's now deceased, had long-time dealings with the CIA, and this is drug running. Counterinsurgency, as Rand stated, is imperial policing. So let me return to David Petraeus' statements that the take-home points of what we learned in Iraq, focus on the people, work across boundaries, exercise initiative, live our values. Let's take it one at a time. Focus on the people. I don't know what people he's focusing on, because today there is a suicide epidemic among returning veterans. Scores of returning veterans are attempting to take their lives every day. And on average, 18 of them succeed every day. Now, if you're going overseas and you're building schools and hospitals, that shouldn't make you come home and want to kill yourself. So while there might be a few nice vignettes of building a school here or helping bringing some medical supplies to that village there, this is the overall picture that we have to pay attention to. And for the Iraqi people, we destroyed their infrastructure. We failed to establish law and order after we invaded. We dissolved civil society. Their healthcare system is beheaded. All the doctors are gone. Their educational system was devastated. We brought the Salvador option and death squads. And women's rights have been set back in Iraq for decades, if not centuries. If you define an orphan as a child who's lost one or both parents, there are 5 million orphans in Iraq today. This is a country of 27 million people. This is the next generation that is devastated. And in the 1990s, with economic sanctions, prostitution emerged in Iraq and has really been vamped up since the invasion and occupation, where human trafficking has emerged. And there's evidence of that, especially among security contractors like DynCorp. We've destroyed the environment in Iraq. We use chemical weapons against the Iraqi people, including napalm and white phosphorus. We use nuclear weapons. This is depleted uranium that I referred to. I have references on it at my website. In total, thus far, since 2003, an estimated between 1.2 and 1.5 million Iraqi dead. And this is a low estimate at this point. This is from 2007. And another more than 5 million refugees. Anytime there's a lack of law and order and violence, you have this problem. This is what we're doing in Libya today with NATO airstrikes. People are running for their lives, and you have a huge refugee problem, in addition to civilian casualties. Number two, work across boundaries. This is Petraeus's development of better communication with U.S. interagency so that the CIA and military are better connected and working together better. And of course, now Petraeus is head of the CIA, so that should help things out some more. If you are working with the CIA or the U.S. military as anthropologists, social scientists, or psychologists, or others in the human terrain system, you have to understand that you are enabling the oppression of occupation. At the very best, that's unethical. At the very worst, you are aiding and abetting in crimes. Exercise initiative. Petraeus says leaders at the small unit level turn high-level big ideas announced by senior leaders into reality on the ground. How's that working out? And living our values. Petraeus writes, the fact that our enemies torture, lie, or kill indiscriminately is no excuse for us to compromise on what we know is right. Well, that's a very nice feel-good statement. But when we send people as our ambassadors who are jacked up on hatred and ready for a fight, then those are the values that are being presented. This is what was known as the Afghanistan Kill Team, a group of soldiers who planned the murder of innocent Afghan civilians. This is a 15-year-old boy whom they murdered and then posed with the body. And this soldier cut off his pinky to take home as a souvenir. This is the reality of what we are doing overseas. We're not helping anybody. Major General Smedley Butler was a Marine in the first part of the last century, one of the most highly decorated Marines in U.S. history. After his military career, he wrote the pamphlet, War is a Racket. And he said, I spent 33 years and 4 months in active military service, and during that period, I spent most of my time as a high-class muscle man for big business, for Wall Street and the bankers. In short, I was a racketeer, a gangster for capitalism. His realms of operation, the Philippines, China, Central America, and the Caribbean. Modern times, this is Southeast Asia and Western Asia. That's what our agenda is. So I will plagiarize Smedley Butler and say that counterinsurgency is a racket. War is a racket. It always has been. This is Smedley Butler. It is possibly the oldest, easily the most profitable, surely the most vicious. It is the only one international in scope. It is the only one in which the profits are reckoned in dollars and the losses in lives. A racket is best described, I believe, as something that is not what it seems to the majority of the people. Only a small inside group knows what it is about. It is conducted for the benefit of the very few at the expense of the very many. Out of war, a few people make huge fortunes. This is what our military operations are about. These are some of my references, and now I just want to show you a very brief 6-minute clip of the results of our operations in Iraq. This is from a Japanese documentary, Toshikuni Doi is the filmmaker. This is after the April siege of Fallujah. This is what people are left with, even after we go home.
قبر شهيد طفل فقط يديه جثة كانت مفقودة أثناء القصف الأمريكي وبقت فقط يديه وتم دفن اليدين فقط طفل اسمه وسيم سعدون طفلتين استشهدا أثناء القصف الأمريكي على مدينة الفلوجة أطفال
في جمعة وحمراء جمعة
ودفنوا في قبر واحد نجد العدوان الأمريكي على مدينتنا
Hey,
two. Five and seven here.
Enough?
Yes. استشهدت هذه المرأة أثناء القصف الأمريكي على مدينة الفلوجة وكانت تحمل طفلها البالغ من العمر 3 سنوات وأثناء القصف استشهدت وكان معلقا في يدها وتم دفنهم في مقبرة الشهداء في الفلوجة القبر يحمل 3 أطفال كذلك تم قصفهم بالطائرات الأمريكية وهم علي وصباح ومحمد
Enough?
That has happened tens of thousands, thousands upon thousands of times again and again. And these people, if they're still alive after the second siege, this is what they live with today. As I told you earlier, the battle for hearts and minds was over before it started. I'm here today with my husband, who served with the Marines during that second siege of Fallujah. He carried a radio. I paid taxes that funded the operation. We'll be here through the day to talk to you, as you like, about our work now to bring an end to these occupations. I'm not sure if there's time, but I can take questions now. There's no time, actually. I'm sorry. I shouldn't have said that. But we will be here, and perhaps in the later Q&A there'll be an opportunity. It's been an honor to be here with you today. Thank you very much.